us Professor Eberhard Wildmann. Wildmann did his studies at the University of Stuttgart, his PhD also there, in collaboration with the local NDI group. Then he did postdoctoral, he had postdoctoral contracts in Japan, at the University of Tokyo, Riken, and then a CERN fellowship at CERN. Most of these were on subjects of antimatter and proton. And he has been a project associate at CERN, a visiting researcher at the University of Tokyo, in the context of the ASAXA experiment. Since 2004, he's been the director of the Stefan Meyer Institute for Subatomic Physics of the Austrian Academy of Science. He received an ERC advanced grant a few years ago, and now he's a co-spokesperson of the SACS experiment at CERN, deputy chair of NUPEC, his committee, and also member of the TIPAC, of the General Program Advisory Committee of GAC SciFair. And today he is going, to introduce us to the matter, to the subject of antimatter, and most precisely he's going to talk about CVP invariants and anti-hydrogen experiments. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the introduction. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
It's the second time that I'm here now. I have been here for the discrete conference for the first time, organized by Pepe Bernabeu. As was said in the introduction, I want to talk about antimatter, what I'm mostly occupied with at the moment, that is spectroscopy of antihydrogen. And what I want to tell you is a bit about where this is going to be done. This is working at CERN. It's one of the machines at CERN called the antiproton decelerator, and there is a new machine now being developed, and after the long shutdown, which is currently happening at CERN, there will be a new machine called ELENA that is going into operation, dedicated to antiproton production and providing into experiments. I will talk a bit about the idea why we are going to do all these experiments, that is CPT symmetry, and in this context also a bit about one of the models that tries to describe, it not explain, but describe CPT symmetry, which is called a standard model extension. And then I will talk about the experiment itself. A few words about how we make antihydrogen. It's an atom which you cannot easily produce. And actually this is at the moment the most critical step for all the experiments that try to work with antihydrogen, is how do I make an atom with a binding energy of only 13 electron volt. And then I will talk about our plans, what we want to do, have a fine spectroscopy, and also a bit what we plan in the future. So, if you talk about antimatter, antihydrogen, you always get this picture. We have normal hydrogen, we know very well. Over many, in the meantime, more than 100 years, we study hydrogen. And we have a CPT conjugate system where instead of an electron orbiting on a proton, we have a positron orbiting an antiproton. And the question immediately rises, if CPT, and I will talk a bit about what is CPT, if the symmetry between matter and antimatter is perfectly conserved, then all the spectra, this here are the optical spectra of hydrogen, starting from the Bohr model, Dirac, Lamb, and to the hyperfine splitting, which we want to study, all the optical spectra should be the same. And since hydrogen is very known very well, and we can do the, in principle, do the same experiments with antihydrogen, provided we can produce enough of it, suitable for spectroscopy, then we can make all the experiments that we have been doing so far with hydrogen, also for antihydrogen. Another topic which I don't want to talk about, but which is being also addressed at the antiproton decelerator, is antimatter gravity, which is a bit specific, because what we can do, this is the experiment here, we have the Earth, and we can compare the acceleration of matter towards the Earth and compare it to antimatter towards the Earth. So it's not a test of CPT. This would require a big anti-Earth where we can make gravity measurements with antimatter. This we cannot do. So what we test here is the weak equivalence principle. That's a test of gravity. And so far, no real quantitative measurement exists at all for antimatter in terms of gravitational acceleration, direct measurement. And so this is one of the topics that two experiments are now going to prepare in the future. But let's stay with the antimatter spectroscopy. Just briefly, this is the collaboration I work with. It's called ASAXA, which has a leading atomic spectroscopy and collisions using slow antiprotons. But it is named after the oldest district of Tokyo, ASAXA, where you can find, if you go there, this big lantern, which has become our trademark. We work also on something I have been doing for a long time, antiprotonic helium, which is another exotic atom containing both matter and antimatter, one antiproton, one electron. This will still continue, but I have now switched to this antihalogen production part, and I'm, as a co-spokesperson, responsible for this part, and this is the team, about 35 people with several, about seven, eight institutions that work together to make this experiment. Good, then let's start. Where do we do the experiment? This is CERN. Most of you have seen this picture of CERN and of the LHC next to the Lac Léman. What we are using, this is then a schematic view of all the accelerators. The LHC is not the only machine at CERN. It needs a lot of pre-accelerators in order to produce the highest energies. And what we are going to use, we are using this proton synchrotron and use the protons from this PS to make antimatter, antiprotons. And this is now cut out of the previous picture. What we do is we have here from the PS 26 GeV protons impinging on the target, and by pair production from the vacuum, we produce a pair of proton antiproton, and this is then captured in a storage ring. The basic principle of producing antiprotons existed at CERN since a long time. It was initially built for the S P bar P S collisions that found the W and the Z boson. We are now using one of the rings, this so-called antiproton desiderator, which is an all-in-one machine that will capture the antiprotons after they are produced, cool them, decelerate them, because we want to do experiments with atomic energy scale, so we want to be in the electron volt range and not in the GeV range. And this is now done, accumulation, deceleration, cooling in this one machine called the AD. This is how it is looking like. The antiproton production target is here. This is one storage ring that does all the capturing, cooling, and deceleration. And for space reasons, all the experiments are inside. So far, half of the ring was filled with experiments, and now the second half is being filled with two more experiments and another decelerator. The important thing is that the production, the end energy of this antiproton decelerator is about 5 MeV, which is very low for particle physics, but for us it's still very high because we want to make an electron volt scale atom. So we have to do first a deceleration, and I will come to that later on. Also what we get is we get pulses of like 20 to 30 millions of antiprotons. They are very short pulses of 100 nanoseconds, but they come only every 100 seconds. So it's a very unusual beam for particle physics or nuclear physics. You cannot do coincidences because you get 20 million particles in a short time scale. But this is adopted to what we want to do. We want to capture them in a trap, in a sort of panning trap. And for that, a short bunch is exactly what we need. The AD is running since 2000. This was one of the early pictures, and now, as I said, since the 5 MeV is still fairly high for us, CERN has agreed to build another deceleration stage from 5 MeV to 100 kV, which is called ELENA. Interestingly, the concept of ELENA already existed since the foundation of LIR, which was 1984. So it's not new in that respect. From the very beginning, people thought about how it could go down, and now it's being realized. It is in this part of the area, and there's one experiment which has already been installed, Shiba, and the second one is going to come here sooner or later. So what we get then is a beam which has 100 kV, and this is much closer to the panning traps, where the capturing voltage is of the order of 10 kilovolt. So this will increase the number of trap antiprotons a lot, so we don't waste anything by slowing it down, we capture them in a trap. And this is now at the moment, the ring is existing, many new beam lines are being installed during this long shutdown, and in 1.5 years, or in a bit more than a year, when everything comes back into operation, this should all work. And the first electron cooling in this low energy ring has also been observed already before the shutdown. So this is the status of the machine. We are looking forward to using very low energy antiprotons, lower than before, and these are the currently running experiments as of this year. Except ASAPSA, there is ALPHA, which makes trapping and spectroscopy. They are also the most advanced. I will show at least one picture from them, one result. There are two experiments, AEGIS and GBAR, which are looking mostly for gravity. And there is the base experiment, which looks not for atoms, but really measures antiprotonic magnetic moments and cyclotron frequencies and so on. So only measuring antiproton properties, no atomic properties. Now, why do we do all this? I guess you're familiar with the fundamental symmetries and CPT, but just for completeness, let me say that in particle physics, symmetries are very, very important, discrete symmetries, and the most important ones are C, which is charge conjugation, or more precisely, particle-antiparticle exchange. There is parity for space inversion, and there is T for time reversal. And this here is kind of a way to describe with a clock running in opposite directions. The important thing is that there is, in the quantum field theory framework used in the standard model, you can prove mathematically that any of these quantum field theories, especially if they are Lorentz invariant, local, and unitary, will obey this CPT, the combined operation of all three fundamental symmetries must be conserved. Strictly mathematical in the quantum field theory framework that we use. Of course, the first thing then is, since we are looking for something beyond the standard model, if we start, for instance, going to string theory, there is no theorem anymore that you can put up that any string theory must obey the same thing. So looking for CPT violation means also, of course, looking beyond the standard model of particle physics. Now, one important consequence of CPT is that particle and antiparticles have to have the same, exactly the same, or exactly the opposite properties. For instance, masses, G factors, the absolute value of the charge is the same, and so on. So to test CPT with matter and antimatter, we can do by just measuring, for instance, masses or hyperfine splittings in and so on. So this gives us access, experimental access to the question, is CPT conserved? And also one more point, which probably also you know, is that in particle physics, violations of fundamental symmetries have played a very important role, starting with the violation of parity, which in the end of the 50s kind of revolutionized the weak interaction, where it was really observed that the weak interaction does not conserve parity. And shortly later on, CP violation, which is a combination of charge and inversion and parity inversion, was also found to be not conserved. And CP violation has been something that has been studied now with Bell and Barbar in the last 15, 20 years, very, very extensively again, and led to a Nobel Prize by its explanation. So these symmetry violations is a very, really important part of particle physics. And we should look for all possible symmetries to be, whether they are conserved or not. And of course, the other thing, if you talk about matter-antimatter symmetry, is the question about the absence of antimatter in the universe. You would assume that if CPT holds during the Big Bang, that you have to produce equal amounts of matter and antimatter at time zero, so to say, if we assume the universe starts from there. But if we look today, we have like a ratio of 10 to minus 9 or so between baryons and antibaryons. So something must have happened in the meantime. There is the standard scenario that has been defined by Sakharov, how you can go from a symmetric universe after the Big Bang to an asymmetric one now, which of course needs CP violation because this creates an asymmetry in its power number non-conservation and the deviation from the thermal equilibrium. And in principle, this can explain asymmetry, but not the degree of asymmetry that we observe. So there must be more than this model to explain what we are really seeing in the universe now. So we can speculate there can be other sources of Baran asymmetry, or another reason why we want to study CPT violation is the asymmetry of the absence of antimatter in the universe, to be precise. So then anti-hydrogen, I will explain a bit now in detail why anti-hydrogen is considered to be one of the really very very interesting parts. Again, you have seen this picture before. This is the energy spectrum, excitation spectrum, so to say, of the hydrogen and the anti-hydrogen atom. And the reason why the prospect is very good is that we have some of the world's most well-known frequencies or physical quantities are measured in hydrogen. This is this here, the 1s2s2 photon spectroscopy. This is now known to about 10 minus 15 relative precision. And the next one is the hyperfine splitting here. 21 centimeter line used in astronomy, a 1.4 gigahertz hyperfine splitting, which is known from MESA measurements to 12 inches. So these are the two quantities that also the experiments at CERN want to measure. And this is it's a bit of a complicated diagram. What I want to show here basically is that those are the three numbers that have been measured for hydrogen. This is the 1s2s2 photon transition frequency with all the digits it is known, and the hyperfine splitting on the same frequency scale. And there is a third part, which has been very important in hydrogen measurements. It's the lamp shift, the difference between 2s and 2p, which is not known exponentially so well because of the large width of the 2p state, but it's also something that could be measured. And this blue part is now, so far, Alpha has already done some laser spectroscopy and some hyperfine spectroscopy. The blue numbers we also know for anti-hydrogen. The yellow numbers we know for hydrogen, and the other important thing to know is that if you look at the 1s2s transition, this is basically a bound state, bound by the electromagnetic force, and the leading order effect there is the reduced mass of the system, which is almost identical to the electron or positron mass. So you both mostly measure, the, first of all, the mass of the positron, and then the mass of the antiproton if you get more precise, while the hyperfine splitting is a spin-spin interaction between two magnetic moments, so it's a completely different interaction, and therefore both measurements are really complementary and should be done. And like Alpha, the Alpha collaboration focuses on this 1s2s, we focus on the hyperfine splitting. So this is another plot. If we now talk about CPT tests and accuracy, there is always a bit of a confusion because we know that the mass of K0 and K0 bar is known to be equal by something like 10 to minus 18 or so. And for this, it's rather useful to look at the measurements that we do on a, now not on a, just the relative position of the measurement scale, but on an absolute scale. And that is depicted here. So for instance, we have the plot here shows the quantity we measure. For instance, this here is the mass of the proton and the mass of the antiproton, which is about, in energy scale, 1 GeV. And it is known by Asakusa, by chance, to better than 10 to minus 8. So the length of this bar gives you the relative position, and then the left part of the bar gives you, on an absolute energy scale, the absolute position that we probe. And we compare mass measurements of different elementary particles. Two different measurements, those three are measurements of antihydrogen, and that one below this bar is a charge to mass ratio measurement, a cyclotron frequency measurement of the proton and of the antiproton. And the important thing that you see is that the atomic physics experiments, if you convert energy into frequency, are much more sensitive than mass measurements because you can measure things, frequencies, much more precisely. and you measure much smaller quantities. Yeah, like the 1.4 gigahertz transition here is already something that is of the order of 10^-13^14 GeV. So the point here is that going to low energy precision measurements using atomic physics techniques is more promising on an absolute scale. And then here, it's the blue ones are all measurements that have been done. The same quantity measured for particle and antiparticle. The orange and yellow ones are those who are planned at the AB. So the important thing is that our hyperfine splitting, if we could measure it as precisely as a maser, and -12, could be the most precise sensitive measurement. Unfortunately, for a maser, you need to confine the atoms in a box of Teflon, and since we don't yet can confine antimatter in an antimatter box, then these measurements are still in the very far future. What we can do is we can make atomic formation. Then we are 3 orders of magnitude less accurate, but still we can go to very high precision. That is the message. Now, another thing for the hyperfine splitting now precisely, one of the things that we will be sensitive to is not only the excitation spectrum of hydrogen, but if you look at the measured value of the hyperfine splitting of hydrogen, which has these 12 digits, and then if you look at the theoretical precision, which is this red arrow, which means the precision theory can reproduce a quantity, there is many digits missing, and this is because of the finite size. It's not a problem of QED. QED could calculate this much more precisely if the charge rate, now the magnetic radius of the proton would be known. And this is the same as what you have probably heard about the muonic hydrogen and the electric charge radius parcel of hydrogen, since the radius is of the proton is not known very well, the spectroscopy has a limit. So this means, on the other hand, at the moment, if you look more closely, you see there is about a 1 part per million agreement, disagreement between theory using, for instance, for electric and magnetic form factors measured at JLab and trying to calculate the corrections that arise from them. So if you reach a ppm level precision, then we will first of all probe the radius of the antiproton. So we probe the internal structure of the proton and not anymore QED or something. So this is important. So our goal from the very beginning is to reach 1 ppm or below, so at least below 10 ppm, so that we get sensitive to this kind of measurement. And of course, what you still need to do is, since the splitting is a spin-spin coupling, you still need to know the magnetic moment of the antiproton precisely enough in order to extract the any structure of the antiproton, and that has been done here by Bayes. They measure the magnetic moment of the antiproton to a few parts per billion. So all these experiments together will finally, in the end, allow us to get some information on, for instance, the structure of the antiproton. The other topic I want to briefly raise with this one foil is when we talk about CPT tests and we talk about comparisons, then it's easy to compare, in a sense, frequencies and energies, masses, because you can just convert it, but it's difficult to compare G-factor measurement with a mass measurement or a hyperfine structure measurement without putting some theory in. And the model that we use in order to compare any kind of CPT test with each other is what is called the standard model extension by Kostoletsky, which is now also more than 20 years old. And this is, again, it's a model that phenomenologically puts into the Dirac equation many, many coefficients that violate Lorentz symmetry, but nothing else. So they are they don't lead to any other effects. So you can just extend the Lagrangian of or the Dirac equation with these coefficients, and then you can measure these coefficients. Of course, they must be very small, because so far we have not seen any deviation from the Dirac equation. But the important thing here is, again, the coefficients like A and B in this equation, they have the dimension of energy or of mass. So this idea that we should look on the mass scale for the smallest sensitivities is coming from this kind of model. And what happens, for instance, since Lorentz invariance is supposed to be broken at some level, you get, for instance, splittings of the ground state Hadamard structure of anti-hydrogen, even at zero external field. So even you don't have an external quantum axis for quantization, you still get a splitting. So this has direct result. Also, that most sensitive in this model are transitions where spins are fit, like the Hadamard splitting. While the 1S2S transition, this would be from this multiplet to another one, lying much lower. Those transitions are to the first optimal sensitive. And then you can again translate whatever measurements you can find in the particle data group or in an archive where Kosteletsky puts all the measurements. In the meantime, there are hundreds of measurements of Lorentz invariants and so on. And you can again compare the yellow bars, the blue bars show the experiment, the experimental precision comparing a particle and an antiparticle property. For instance, Alice has measured the anti-helium 3 and anti-helium 4 mass by 2% or so. And then if you put in the standard model extension, you get these orange bars that correspond then to a dedicated analysis of the experiment and to one of the coefficients that you see here. And again, you see that the most sensitive ones are those where you make measurement at moments. And the K0, K0 bar mass is sensitive, but not the most sensitive one anymore. Anti-hydrogen, this is pale because so far the measurements that have been done are not sensitive to any of those coefficients. So this is still, for anti-hydrogen, it's uncharted. But this is another way to look at comparing different tests of CPT, and again, an argument why we should go towards atomic physics measurements using anti-atom. Good, so much to the foundation of why we do all this. Now a bit about how we are going to do this. The first thing, of course, is we have to make the atoms. That has been done for the first time in 2002, about 2 years after the proton decelerator has been get into operation. And what we use is so-called nested panning traps. Now this is a schematic here. We have a stack of cylinders where we put an electric potential that if you put the voltage as a function of the distance here, gives you a curve with two different kind of minima, with positive curvature and with negative curvature. So those are electric potential minima, so this means in one of them you can put positrons, in the other one you can put antiprotons, because they have an opposite charge. And then a panning trap is, in addition, a very strong longitudinal magnetic field overlap, so that the charged particles cannot escape radially because they are on spirals confined to the magnetic field, and then you have the electric potential that reflects them when they reach the end. So this way you can put charged particles into a so-called ion trap. And this is the way all the experiments so far at CERN, except there has been one other method demonstrated, but it has never been used to in a big way. Nested panning traps is the way we make anti-hydrogen. And Asina at that time has shown that in the panning trap, once you make a neutral atom, it is not confined anymore by static homogeneous field. They drift to the wall, annihilate, and you can measure both the antiproton and the positron annihilation and show that really you have seen an antihydrogen atom there. And this was a discovery in the year 2002, and since then we are trying to make cold antihydrogen because it's not enough to have made the atom, we have to be able to interrogate it with microwave or laser spectroscopy. Here is one more view of how our experiments look like in practice. I was talking about the trap here where we mix, the so-called mixing trap. In addition, you need, first of all, to get the antiprotons from the AD, since they come with still hundreds or more keV energy. You also have to capture them first in the trap. This is this blue one in our case. Positrons is easier. You can buy sodium-22, beta plus emitter, and put it here and accumulate positrons also in a panning trap. And then you move both into this one trap where you mix them. And then behind it, we have built spectrometer line where you have a microwave cavity to make the excitation, another inhomogeneous field to see whether the spin orientation has changed and detect them. And this here is how it looks into the area, a bit chaotic. So this is the setup, and the important thing is that we need a lot of techniques. We need plasma physics because the positrons that we use have such a high density in order to have high formation rate that they are in a plasma state. We need to work with traps, we need to work with, for detection is particle physics. I will show you how to detect afterwards. So it's a huge amount of different skills that you need, and all the groups that we have, some come from particle physics, some come from plasma physics, some come from atomic physics. And this is just once more to show you the mixing. I showed you this nested panning trap potential. It's much more complicated. This is typically this stack of electrodes that we have, where we can, each electrode has a different potential, and we produce this kind of very complex potentials over a distance of about 30-40 centimeters. And then the very important thing is that we can have antiprotons at one point, positrons at another point, and then we move them to overlap spatially. And here, this is the very tricky part, because if we move plasmas in such trap, if we do it wrong, we can excite them. We can excite some resonances. We lose the particles, and the way how we make this merging here, for instance, this is the most tricky way, and especially, as I will show later on, we have to have the whole system as cold as possible to get enough rate. So here we are at the moment working hard in order to optimize the production of antihydrogen. This is really something you cannot calculate how you should do it. It's really something in trial and error, and most of the experiments spend most of their time in getting this formation right. Good. Then the spectroscopy that we are planning, we want to make a beam. But before that, I just want to show one slide. The Alpha Collaboration has managed to capture also the antihydrogen they make. I talked about ion traps, where magnetic and static magnetic and electric fields can confine charged particles. And what they have done is, on top of this trap, they put a neutral atom trap. A neutral atom trap is a trap with a strongly inhomogeneous magnetic field, and there you couple to the magnetic moment of the positron in this case. So this is a magnetic gradient field, and the magnetic moment of the positron will give a force and will collect the particles down here. The depth here is only half a Kelvin or so. So you have to be very, very cold in order to be able to do this. And then once the particles are in there, you can also try hyperfine spectroscopy. And what you see down here is this Pipe-Arby diagram. This shows the splitting of the ground state hyperfine structure of hydrogen or antihydrogen as a function of external field. You get a singlet state and a triplet state for if you have two spin 1/2 particles, and the triplet state stays split in an external field according to this. And the particles that will stay in the magnetic trap are those where the lower the field is, the lower the energy, so they sit somewhere in here, and then if you shine in a microwave with this difference, then you can make the spin flip and then they disappear. The problem in this trap is that the bias field here is 1 tesla. So this means you don't measure the magnetic field, the hyperfine splitting at zero field, where you can compare to theory, but at a very high field. And therefore, what we want to do, we want to take the particles out of the magnetic field and go somewhere down here where we can directly measure the 1.4 gigahertz split. So the alpha has had a first measurement with an accuracy of about 0.5 per mil on this hyperfine splitting. And they use a combination of transitions which is not sensitive to anything in the standard model extension. So now how do we want to do it? This is a very sketchy part. What we need to do is if we make an experiment that is called an Arby type experiment, because it was this molecular beam method invented by Arby in the 1930s, we need to make a polarized beam, and then this is done here. Then we have a microwave cavity that induces a transition, and then we have another field gradient which sees whether the spin has changed or not. And the way we make a polarized beam is that we don't use for the mixing, we use what we call a cusp trap. So it's not a homogeneous magnetic field, but it's these yellow field lines that are made by having ring currents go the opposite direction. So it's anti-Helmholtz configuration. So we have the current going here left and here right. This creates this very strange magnetic field, and that creates a gradient that focuses this the beam and focuses again low field seekers onto the cavity. So with this so-called cusp trap, we produce here already a polarized beam. And that is the idea. And then we are at very low magnetic field, and still we need a small guiding field, and then we make transition series in this hyperfine splitting of different changes in delta m. Can be delta m equals zero, delta m equals one. And in a nutshell, the idea is that if we have if you make a beam experiment, then the line width of your transition that you can observe is determined by the time of flight of the atoms through the cavity. This just gives a Fourier transform, gives you a finite width. And this goes with 1 over the time it takes through. And then if we have a beam of about 1,000 meters per second, that would be 50 Kelvin, which is typically the temperature we have here of our blast mass. And it goes through a 10 centimeter long cavity, which we also built. Then the line width is already a few ppm. So without doing anything, we will have an accuracy of better than 10 ppm. And if we, of course, can measure with higher statistical accuracy, we can determine the line width better than the line center better than the line width, then we can easily get into the ppm. And another calculation, very simple, tells you, since we are the detectors here, 3 meters away from the formation region, we need about 100 antihydrogen formed per second in the ground state, going into 4 pi here, in order to see, to be able to do a scan within a week or two. So that is roughly the. So it doesn't look so difficult. Annihilation rates of 100 per second have been observed in these pending traps. The temperature of 50 Kelvin is typically what we expect. So this would make the experiment, in principle, doable. Now where we are, this is all together. We have built, this is the schematic view, this is the technical drawing of the real setup with the mixing trap, the cavity for making the spin flip, sextuple for spin analysis, and the detector to measure the antiproton annihilations. And we have made several steps. We have made the first antihydrogen in this configuration in 2010. We have seen the first antihydrogen atoms here, now without any spectroscopy, just putting a detector and looking what comes out in 2014. And what we have seen, we have measured that this is really antihydrogen, and we have measured the distribution of binding states. So this is the first measurement we did. This is the difference between if we mix antiprotons and positrons, or if we just put antiprotons without positrons. And the background, so to say, is this slight blue histogram. This is a Bijou detector where we shoot the antihydrogen in and we measure the energy loss coming from the annihilation, the energy deposit, while the white histogram is the yellow, with the blue boundary, is the one if we do really mixing. So this is mixing yes, mixing no, and we see a rather strong enhancement of a large energy deposit coming from the annihilation. P-bar-P annihilation goes into pions plus fragments, so the nucleus explodes and all these fragments deposit a lot of energy. So this was the first sign that we see antihydrogen. It's still not very many. We had about 80 in the shift, and we produce here in the order of 6 events per 15 minutes at the end of the beam where we want to do the spectroscopy. So this is not a lot, but in principle, and also the significance at that time was 4 point something sigma, so it's just at the edge, but we could see the first antihydrogen. Then we improved our detection scheme and also more mixing scheme, so we built a rather elaborate two-layer otoscope, which for particle physicists is a very familiar thing. So just scintillating bars without this silicon photomultipliers. It's about 50 centimeters long and then 30 centimeters inner diameter, so it's a very small device, and this can just track pions that come out. And we put in the center here, we put a BGO, that's an anorganic scintillator that can be used as a calorimeter. That just records the energy loss deposited there by the ionization. And what we spent a lot of time in optimizing the detection efficiency, and since we have a rate of less than one per minute, the largest background is cosmic. So we achieved in the end, using machine learning techniques, which are now very common in particle physics, we achieved a rejection, a PBR efficiency of 80% and a rejection of 98% of cosmics, so that we really have a very good signal. And we then could, by doing field ionization, we could look at the distribution of antihydrogen in quantum states. So this here are number of antihydrogens observed as a function of their quantum state. And we see, as expected, that most of them are in a Hilbert state. And this comes from the way we form antihydrogen. This is in this plasma. We mix antiprotons with a dense positron plasma. And the most likely collisions are so-called three-body recombination, which leads to Hilbert states. So this is not surprising, but still expected. So we have a very high, most of them are in a very high state. And we see a few in a quantum number of order n equals 10. And for those, they have radiatively, they decay fairly quickly in the ground state. So everything up to n equals 10 or so should be in the ground state before it reaches the cavity. So this green ones here are the ones that we, in principle, should be able to do spectroscopy with. Still, we have, out of this very low quantum state ones, we produce now 1.4 per cycle, which is still 15 minutes. Is not very much, and that is why we have to really improve on the formation. And we have two ways. This is now all atomic collision physics, or atomic physics. We have two ways we want to go. It is known from also from alpha that the formation rate of antihydrogen goes up if the temperature of the positrons where they are stopped inside goes down. So this here are numerical calculations using known or calculated atomic cross sections. For instance, the what can happen if you have an antihydrogen which is in excited state going through a positron plasma in the collision, it can be de-excited. So this is this process here, and this can be simulated. And here we have the temperature of the positron plasma and its density. And it shows that the lower the temperature and the higher the density, the more of the atoms will come out at the end in the ground state. We have to look at the competing process of ionization. Of course, the Rydberg states can also be ionized in such collisions, but luckily, the ionization is higher for higher temperatures. So if we can come here, and that means we have to go to 20 Kelvin for the positrons, and to a very high density, then we can de-excite them by collision. That is something we are trying now. Even we have set up a system where we can make hydrogen from protons and electrons in the same way. And the other way, of course, is it's fairly common in Rydberg atom physics to try to de-excite Rydberg states by either lasers. Laser is, of course, narrow-banded, but you can use terahertz radiation. You can produce several lines of terahertz radiation that can de-excite a whole bunch of Rydberg states into one low-lying state, which then can again be de-excited by laser. And we did extensive simulations, and we have a scheme where we could use terahertz radiation and, in addition, a laser of 800 something nanometer to increase the ground state fraction also to 80% if this all works. So this is now again something we try with hydrogen. It's easy to make an excited hydrogen beam. And so these are schemes that we want to elaborate. So this was all about antihydrogen in the last time. I want to say a bit about what we do with hydrogen. As I said already here, for this studies, we don't need antihydrogen. We can make a hydrogen beam. We have actually already some time ago started to make a polarized hydrogen beam. using first of all a microwave discharge to make atomic hydrogen out of H2, which comes from a bottle, and cooling it down and making a beam that has also 50 Kelvin. And we use for detection, we just use a quadruple mass spectrometer, which you can use for atoms, and then in between we put our apparatus, which we use for anti-hydrogen. And the first idea was that we prove that the principle works. We measure the hyperfine splitting of hydrogen in such a beam. This here is a very complex scheme. The beam, again, that we make, then the microwave transition part with a applied homogeneous small magnetic field and a detector. And what we really see, we can, if we make a resonance scan at one certain setting of the magnetic field, we get this kind of double dip structure, which corresponds to the theoretical line shape that comes from some specific feature of the setup. When you take the center here and you change the magnetic field that we apply, we get this parabola, and if we extrapolate to zero external field, in the end we got the hydrogen hydrogen splitting to a few parts per billion without any big effort and still statistically dominated, so no systematic effort. So the message here is that, okay, we can do it. We aim at ppm or better, but the method, with enough statistics, and this was another thing, we, by analyzing the statistical data here, we conclude that we need a few thousand atoms in the ground state in order to make a ppm measurement. Yeah, we need many, many more to make a ppb measurement, but just statistical assumptions, assuming we have the same line widths, same line shape, with a few thousand atoms, we can do ppm. This was the first major outcome. The other outcome is we can measure ppb and maybe better with the beam, and this is one thing we want now to try, and there again comes this standard model extension in play. In the latest version, the non-minimal so-called standard model extension, there are coefficients where that depend on the orientation of the external applied magnetic field. And this we can do easily. We can make a field that goes east-west and west-east, and we should be able to measure the frequencies in this condition, and and put some limits on it and discover some Lorentz invariance violation there. Again, this is a measurement of Lorentz invariance violation, not of CPT, but this can be done. And this is something we want to explore now in the next time. And then the last part that is going in not in the very far future, but in terms of CERN into RAM 4. CERN will start the RAM 3 now after the long shutdown 2, going from 21 to 24. And then after the next shutdown, we are probably hopefully in a shape that we can go one step beyond the beam measurements, and this is a standard technique. This is called the Ramsey technique. Also has been invented by Ramsey in the 1950s, where you put, instead of having one cavity and this polarizer and analyzer, you put two cavities in a distance that are coherently oscillating, and then you get some beating noise. And you get a narrower line width through this so-called Ramsey method, and essentially you get an improvement in the line widths by the ratio of the length of one cavity to the distance between those two. And what we aim at is like a factor 10. Like this is 10 centimeters long and we have a 1 meter distance in between. So we can get, and together with a more sensitive detection scheme and so on, we think we can get a factor 20 or so improvement. So this would bring us, if you had 1 ppm with Rabi at some point, we could get into the 10 parts per billion region. And then we can, of course, the colder we get with the atoms. In this case, the line width here is always given by the time of light through the cavity. If we can make the source colder, we can get a narrow line width and therefore increase the precision. For hydrogen, it's easy to get from a 50 Kelvin beam to a 1 Kelvin beam, and someday maybe even to a fountain, where we can make them so slow, and that means they have only 1 meter per second velocity, then they go up in the gravity for meter and fall down. And this is really something which is in the far future, but this could be to give the most precision, and then we could reach parts per billion. Good, with that I want to wrap up. since more than 20 years, the idea has now been running, and at the end of this 20-year period, this is also an important thing to realize, that it really takes decades if you want to do this kind of precision spectroscopy. At the end of these 20 years, we have seen first spectroscopy results with Aljanushin from the Alpha collaboration. They have measured several transitions, 1s2s, the two-photon transition, 10^-12, then the 1s2p, 1-alpha transition, cannot be measured very precisely because the 2p state has a large width, and they have also seen a hyperfine split in the trap. So that is the first spectroscopy result. So far, nothing has been done in terms of SAV coefficients because the way the measurements were done are not sensitive. And for that, I think the NIM spectroscopy is more promising because we go into a field-free region where we don't have systematic background. And we can also measure this kind of orientation-dependent coefficients more precisely. We are waiting now for the ELENA beam coming up in 2021, and it should run for 4 years, roughly, until the next long shutdown. And in this period, we will see a lot of spectroscopy happening in the ELENA. Also, our goal is to do the first PPM measurement, and maybe even go towards Arc in the end. And the other message is that ELENA, since it starts operation now, it's clear that it will run the next 10, 15 years. So there will be enough time and opportunity to do very precise spectroscopy of any hydrogen. And with this, I want to thank the sponsors and thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Eberhard, for this interesting colloquium. And congratulations, not only because of the presentation, but for something that I think is true. It's the first time since the Big Bang that antihydrogen is being produced. When we talk about top and antitops, we recreate in the laboratory what the nature was doing at the beginning of the universe. However, in my opinion, antihydrogen was never produced naturally. That means I think it's the first time since the Big Bang that this system is being produced. I don't know. Okay. Now, apart from discovered, I have a physical question on physics. You were talking about the motivations for looking the violation of CPT. The CPT theorem is something which is specific to a given theory, which is quantum field theory, local quantum field theory. You see, I like to repeat many times that nothing happens in quantum mechanics if CPT is violated. It's a question of quantum field theory, not of quantum mechanics, okay? And even if nature doesn't care about our opinions, I would like to ask you one thing, which is an opinion. Among the assumptions of the CPT theorem, what is the ingredient that you think is weaker, we can call. I have an opinion also, even if nature doesn't care about that. But I ask you, what is about Lorentz invariance, locality, conservation probability, all these things? What is, in your mind, you see the assumption that is weaker?
That's a very difficult question. I think that there's no indication from anywhere which one it should be. It's very hard to say. I mean, Lorentz invariance violation is something that we can test, and probably that's why there are so many activities with this SME going on, but it's not because it's most likely. one then is violated, it's the easiest one to test. So I don't have a strong opinion on which one should be the one. But you have
May I elaborate a little bit again? Okay. Locality is locality of interactions. In my mind, points are mathematical abstractions. I cannot imagine true points in nature, true mathematical points in nature, which is what you are assuming in local quantum field theory, that the interaction is in the same mathematical point. And this is why exchange forces and so on were created, but I think this is a very weak point in local quantum field theory. My prediction, not perhaps for next year, is that the big next big revolution in physics will come from the violation of CPT. And then, you see, more than symmetries like Lorentz invariant and so on, I think this question of locality, I think, is very feeble, okay, in a sense. I don't know. I don't know whether, at the end I say always, nature doesn't care about our opinions, but.
Yeah, well, that's a good point.
Yeah.
Other questions?
Yeah.
Are there any plans to make anti-helium?
I mean, one of the.
Yes.
Well, as I hinted, anti-helium has, anti-deuterons have been made already observed. Anti-helium has indeed been seen by IEs, in heavy ion collisions. But in order to make any study so far, there has been no effort. I mean, there is now some discussion at the AD whether it's feasible to produce anti-deuterons and capture a few. But if you make it the way of having a beam going onto a target, then anti-helium is probably requiring very, very high energy. I don't know whether the SPS could make anti-deuterons the same way. Anti-helium is very heavy. And also there is no strong physics case for anti-helium.
More questions?
So when you produce the antiprotons, you accelerate them to 100 keV or something like this,
yep.
And then you inject them into a trap which is optimized for 10 keV or so. So what is preventing you from accelerating them more?
There are two more practical things. You know, the lower you go with the energy in an accelerator, the more difficult it gets. 100 kV is already very, very low. The other thing is that we usually need some very thin foil to separate the vacuum of the traps, which is 10 minus 12 or better, from the beam vacuum. And this foil usually, already now, we are using a 100 kV beam and a 1 micron foil. And that's just then the best thing to do. To make the foil thinner will be difficult. So it's more or less a very practical thing. Still, we expect to lose like almost half of the particles in this foil that I need it. But this seems to be the best compromise.
Okay, thank you.
I mean, there's another thing people have been using for, like in Isolde, so-called drift tubes, where you then put a tube on a potential, electrical potential, and by the beam goes through, you lower it. That is also something that has been used that we would have to put beyond to go from 100 kV to 10. In principle, the technology exists, but it has not been put to working with antiprotons. But now, we go from 0.5% to 50%. And then if you go from 50 to 70, the last 20% is not that important anymore, so we do it the easiest way.
Any other comment? Or question? Or reflection? Then